Gary, the price of food is going up faster than inflation. Who is responsible for higher food prices, for setting those food prices? Give us the 101.
The fact is, I can't point to any one boogeyman out there that exists. There's just a myriad of factors out there that's creating the perfect storm. Everything from that we've had in the last few months, from climate calamities, flooding in BC, droughts in California. We've had, border blockades. We've had we still have the war in the Ukraine and Russia taking place, which is having a continued ripple effect on the supply chain. You know, if somebody were to say to the average grocer in Canada that the four horsemen of the apocalypse were joining the food industry, they would just shrug and say, well, that sounds just about right. There's just so many factors taking place. And, you know, and we can't lose sight of the big one that's been hitting the labor front is the challenges of COVID. And that has created delays and added costs right through the entire supply chain.
Let's get into some of those challenges. We know that in Canada, there are five major grocery chains that control, I guess, about 80% of grocery sales. You represent independent grocers. Is a lack of competition one of the reasons why food prices are going up?
I actually, you know, listen, I'm being straight up with you. I don't represent the chains, and we have lots of issues with respect to consolidation. We do believe there's an over-consolidation in the retail sector in Canada for sure. But in terms of having an impact on the price of food, I would have to say no. It is all the factors that we've identified. You know, we get the same notices of price increases from suppliers that the chains do. You know, they might have more ability sometimes to push back in terms of those price increases with suppliers. But in this case, I would not point to consolidation as having an impact on prices. I think notwithstanding some of the perceptions out there, I think even the chains are being very, very sensitive to consumer concerns around affordability.
Tell us where negotiations stand. We know that legislators and grocery, I guess, leaders have been pushing for a new code of conduct with respect to just getting that balance right between grocers and suppliers and independents. So where do we stand now with those negotiations?
Well, we're very, very close to the finish line. I'm one of those leaders you identified. I'm on the steering committee, so we are bound by confidentiality provisions. But I can tell you that we expect in the very, very next few short weeks to be presenting a report to all of the governments across Canada. And we'll obviously be sharing that with the media and with the public at that time. We've made a lot of progress, I can tell you, addressing some of the issues that are out there. And one of the issues I'll touch on that's been a great concern for independents has been the issue of fair supply. You know, I just have to remind people that, you know, in Canada, we have about 6,900 independent grocers in Canada, and they're spread out across this country, but many of them are in semi-rural, rural, remote communities, even servicing Indigenous communities where there's no other grocery store in town. That's it. And so the issue of fair supply is critical. And when you're not getting fair supply, you're treading pretty close to the issue of concern to governments and those communities of food security. So that's an issue that we're talking about in the context of the grocery code, is making sure that that principle of fair supply is recognized. And there's other issues that we'll be, you know, we've been talking about, which are no secret. I can't tell you what the code is going to look like in turn. I'm not at liberty to say that, but, you know, one of the other issues was of concern to the suppliers were the fees or fines and charges, et cetera, levied by the retail chains on the suppliers. And I think Walmart and Loblaws, there's a lot of media attention around that. I think it was around mid-2020 that got quite a lot of attention for that. And that's also one of the pillars that will be addressed in the code.
We have been seeing the profits posted by the big companies. What are your thoughts on the notion that these big grocery chains are profiting from food inflation?
I just circle back, and again, I hope you believe me that I'm not here to act as an apologist or defend the chains. I can only tell you, comparing the food industry for independents, the food sector, and the food sector for the chains, we're in the same boat right now. And you know, margins for grocery chain and independent are about 1.5 to 2%. They're very tight, and much lower actually than other retail sectors in Canada. So again, I'm seeing the same notices of price increases. I got a couple more this morning that are going out to our members from big companies where prices are going up by 10% in January. So I really don't buy into the notion of greedflation taking place in the food sector. I just think that it's not accurate. It's there's no evidence to support that perception. And like I said, I'm seeing the same increases for the independents that the chains are getting.
And lastly, what are the biggest concerns from your members? You had mentioned that some of these independent grocers are in rural or remote areas. How is inflation affecting them?
Well, they tend to be more pronounced in those communities that you're talking about. And the reason for that, you know, we tend to forget about those things when we're in Toronto, Montreal, Vancouver, or the big urban centers in Canada. But the cost of transporting goods to those communities, even at the best of times, is always more significant. Add on to, you know, the pressures that are now being felt across the industry in the supply chain through all of the issues we talked about earlier that are causing prices to rise. They're more, those have a more pronounced impact on those rural and remote communities. So, for example, fuel surcharges in many of those communities in Canada have actually tripled. And if your fuel surcharges and your delivery charges are tripling, there's just no way you can avoid not passing on those increases onto the consumer. So inflation is more of a concern in those communities to us, because we know the cost pressures are higher, you know, and this is Canada. We're coming up to the winter, transportation and it is more difficult at this time of the year. We rely more on imports. So I think you're going to see even more concerns about inflation and those pressures on those communities in the months ahead.